Hello， 大家好，欢迎观看网易公开课原创栏目 ATalk 英语访谈。今天做客我们节目的嘉宾是来自浙江师范大学的资深外教 Andrea Horrigan 女士。
Hi, my name is Andrea Horrigan, and I am a university expert at Zhejiang Normal University. I am from the UK. I've been here 4 years.
That's good. Welcome. Welcome to ATalk. Welcome to Netease, Andrea. How are you?
Really good. I can't believe how hot it is in Beijing. This is my first time in Beijing.
Ah, welcome to Beijing.
Thank you.
How do you like it here?
I really like it. I didn't know what to expect. Mm-hmm. My friend and I have come to visit a colleague of ours, a former colleague, and she's teaching at Minzu
Da Xue.
Yeah, and it's really nice. So we arrived last night from Jinhua.
Zhejiang province. Yeah.
And so here I am here today to come and see you at Netease.
Great.
Huge. I'm really impressed.
Good. It's great to have you here. Thank you. Thank you for being on the show. How long have you been teaching in China?
This is my fourth year.
Fourth year.
I'm just finishing up my fourth year. And I've renewed my contract again for another year at the same university.
Zhejiang Normal University.
That's right.
I see. What courses are you teaching there?
I've been teaching English major courses to mainly freshman students. And the next academic year, I'm going to teach a new course, which is fine art college students and advanced business English students.
That's good. Yeah.
I like to challenge myself, something new.
Excellent, yeah. So I'm sure you're like an expert at teaching those college students. And do you think, in your opinion, what are some challenges do you think they're facing with studying English?
For me, teaching oral English, I would say the majority of my students, I've never met a foreign person before. And then also, they've not had a foreign teacher. So they're first year students, freshman students, so they're very, very nervous. And most of them have probably been studying English for possibly 10 years.
10 years, yeah.
So this is their first time to actually speak English to a foreign person and also listen to a native speaker, a British speaker. Many of them, my experience, they know more American English because they watch a lot of American movies, films.
Just like me, when I was a student.
So they got to get used to my accent as well.
So it takes time to get used to the British accent.
Yeah.
And also, I'm pretty sure it's understandable why they would be nervous to talk to a foreigner for the first time, So are there like techniques that you use in the classroom to help them overcome this kind of nervousness?
I think this is what they tell me. They feel very free, very relaxed. The atmosphere, this is what they tell me. They feel relaxed, they're not so afraid of me. They're just probably nervous because they've never spoken English.
There's no need to be afraid.
Well, they tell me they're afraid of making mistakes. So it's the education system's different. And I said, but that's how you learn, is keep on practicing. It's okay to make mistakes. I make mistakes all the time.
Yeah, me too. We all make mistakes, right? We're all human, we make mistakes. As long as we don't make the same mistakes, right?
Exactly.
So if you make mistake, then you correct it next time. You won't make the same mistake again. That's an improvement. So it kind of like the more mistakes you make, actually, the more progress you'll be able
to
make. Right?
And it's a process. And everyone works differently, learns differently.
Yeah.
So in one class of 30 students, they all have different strengths and different weaknesses in oral English, you know. So some are better at listening. You know, some are great at speaking, but if I ask them a question, they go, oh, because they don't understand, because it's kind of memorized, it's rehearsed, so they're not used to it. So that's why the oral classes are really good, I think. And I think for me and for them, for the first semester, it takes at least maybe 8-12 weeks to really get to know each other.
8-12 weeks, about 2 or 3 months time.
Yeah, it really takes time. And then suddenly, boom, they've got it, you know.
Suddenly, so, they're able to speak freely.
Totally. Usually, I start my classes with different types of music. to warm them up, get their mind thinking.
What kind of music do you play in the class? Like warm-up music?
Everything. It can be classical, it can be R&B, it can be soul, it can even be Chinese music as well, because they teach me things about Chinese culture too. So it's a two-way thing, you know? Mm-hmm. So I learn a lot from them too.
And
we learn songs as well. So recently, they're learning more like pop current music rather than, no disrespect to the Beatles, I love the Beatles, but it's usually an old song to learn. So I said, let's learn new current pop music artists, you know? So they love Adele.
Yes, yeah.
They love, Taylor Swift. They love Taylor Swift.
Katy Perry.
Are kind of easy songs to learn. Yeah. And they like it, so they enjoy it.
Very good.
So their heart goes into
it. That's a key point, right? When you want to really learn something well, you have to really have the interest.
Yeah.
In it, you really have to love it.
Yeah,
and also by listening to English songs, pop songs, new songs, the lyrics, now all the modern words, new words, right? Those words can be used in to help them with oral English or spoken English.
Yeah.
If old songs has the old words, old structures, maybe some of them are outdated. So it's better to keep your language fresh, updated.
Totally, yeah. And it energizes them. I feel there's a difference. Because usually they're rushing to get to class. They have to walk quite a lot on our campus. So we have a very big campus.
Oh, Andrew's class is about to begin.
Yeah, literally. Yeah, it takes them at least 20 minutes but walking. And many of them are not used to walking, right? Because, they lived in a high school or something. Mm-hmm. So it was within walking distance, you know?
Yeah, I see, yeah.
So when they get there, they're like, like that. So music is really good.
To calm them down.
Not like straight in, you know?
Mm-hmm.
And I get them to do presentations because I want them to learn to speak in front of people, because most of them want to become teachers, English teachers.
Yeah,
or translators or interpreters, or some of them want to work in international business.
Mm-hmm.
So it's a good skill to have. And they can choose any topic. So again, it's down to their interest, which means then I feel I get more out of them.
Yeah,
because they put more into the presentation, the skills, and so on. And I think they've learned a lot from that as well. It's good
Very
for me
good.
To assess them up that way.
Yeah, to do the presentation is also a very good way to help them like sell certain things, sell themselves, and also to be standing in front of a classroom is kind of like a stage fright, right? Mm-hmm. If you want in the future become a teacher or be like a speaker to talk in front of a lot of people, you have to overcome the stage fright to do this kind of practice more often.
Yes, yeah, absolutely.
Very good. I'm glad to know you are, as a teacher, you give those students this kind of great opportunity to practice them, to strengthen these kind of presentational skills.
Yeah, totally. And they are speaking more, and sometimes I randomly choose students. So they're not kind of expecting for me to ask them a question now that we know each other more. But when I first did this, they were like,
they're afraid of making mistakes.
Yeah. Now they're not.
Do you correct them often in the classroom whenever they make a mistake?
Straight away, not immediately. It depends. Because sometimes I break them up into groups as well. So we discuss different topics. It can be anything. Something that could be controversial. Or something that's very simple. I don't know, for example, a holiday. Or a good place to go to China, like traveling in China. So, you know, you're advising or...
Everyday topics.
Yeah,
right.
So, of course, they learn new words. They also learn a lot of knowledge. You know, because that's the other thing I find. They tend to be very busy. They do a lot of studying and a lot of homework. So they don't get to practice their oral English outside the classes.
And also
read in English, like world knowledge, world news. So I post links, information about world news or something current, current affairs on my Weishi. So they even have my Weishi, right? So they learn, I'm exposing them. I mean, they can take it or leave it, you know, I'm not. But I just think that's a good way. Yeah. And I get good feedback from my students because of that. So that and I'm learning all the time too, because each class, each student is different. So I learn a lot from them as well.
Good. That's like a bonus of teaching students, right? You teach them, and also you also learn something from them in return.
Yeah, absolutely.
You also taught in Britain before.
Mm-hmm.
You know about British students, how they learn, how they you know, practice in school. What are some differences have you found out regarding, you know, Chinese students and British students?
From my experience, they tend to ask a lot more questions. They're encouraged from a very young age to be interactive. Mm-hmm. So they're constantly asking questions, question the teacher more about many things. Don't take as face value, you know.
Mm-hmm.
Rather than sitting there and having a lecture. So we learn from a young age to ask questions, to explore, to be more curious, you know. Mm-hmm. So maybe we're not so afraid of that. So
courageous in this field. Mm-hmm.
So my students tell me they're not used to that. They're not used to being asked questions, you know, because they've attended lectures for many years and they don't, maybe they question it, but maybe you're afraid to question the teacher.
Yeah, afraid to question the authority. It's like teaching stands for authority. We're not taught to challenge authority.
Yeah, absolutely. And when I taught English in Spain, completely different
culture.
What's
the different experience there? Yeah.
Oh, very loud.
The students were loud.
Yeah, really loud. So
they're very confident.
Absolutely. Lots of passion. They're very passionate Spanish people are.
Ah, okay.
Compared to the British. And to Chinese, I think, we are more reserved, actually, compared to the Spanish. So it's a different experience and fun, but also tiring, stressful in different ways, though. You know, it's trying to get that balance.
Yeah.
So of course, they're more active then,
which
means then they're practicing their oral English more. So they're quick. They're quick at learning, being able to speak English because they're so active.
I see. So this is something Chinese students really need to learn from, right?
Absolutely.
You have to be passionate, active, and loud.
Yeah, right? Yeah,
that
absolutely
can really help you increase the proficiency, right? Or efficiency in learning English.
Yeah, definitely.
Are there any interesting anecdotes that happened in your career of teaching English?
You know, I was thinking on the way, and I said there are plenty, but I was like, my mind is blank. I can't think of any right now, the top of my head. And we have many stories.
Yeah.
We have some interesting names.
Yeah. I know some Chinese students, they tend to give themselves some really interesting names. Like they name themselves like river, dragon, apple, banana, watermelon. Sometimes I heard these kind of names before.
Mm. I have a few. I have one student called Slim.
Slim? Ah, because she wants to be slim?
No, it's a male.
A male?
So Slim, I thought, Slim Shady.
Ah, yeah.
Right? Mm-hmm. And it is. And he's great. He's very creative. He's one of my very good students. And he works for the university radio station. We have a radio station as well.
Radio station,
So yeah, he's very curious, very interested in and loves music. So Slim, I thought straight away. I have another male student, his name is Pink Floyd.
Pink Floyd?
Right? So Pink Floyd is Pink, right?
Exactly the same names?
Yeah.
Okay, and that's just how big of a fan he or she is.
Yeah. I have a female student, her name is Hiccup.
Hiccup?
Yeah.
Really?
Yeah.
Is that a joke or a real name?
No, that's her name, that's her English name.
Oh,
she's a great photographer, loves photography.
Did she tell you why she gave herself such a name, Hiccup?
She said, no, Hiccup? I just like it, she says. I went, okay.
She liked the sound?
Yeah. And it's not similar to her Chinese name either. And another student called Harry, as in Harry Rush. So one of those students.
I see. Are there any maybe advice you can give to the Chinese English learners, what are some maybe proper way, a better way to name themselves? Sometimes they just translate the Chinese name literally from Chinese into English. That's why you hear people call them like apple or river or sky, because it has that name in Chinese.
I know what you mean.
But usually that may not be very appropriate to to call that.
I agree with that to a certain point, because especially if they're going to apply for a job, for example, with an international company, and then they end the email, their resume with Sky or
Sky.
Are they going to take them serious, you know? So I've mentioned this, but, you know, you just have to be aware of that.
Exactly.
I mean, there was one student, he called himself Clean.
Clean,
as in dirty clean. And I'm like, where did you get that from?
Oh, yeah, that's clean. In Chinese, it's called Jing. Jing, maybe her name is called Jing. Then she just translated literally from Jing to clean.
And I thought,
you're clean, you're not dirty.
Yeah.
Good to know.
So we renamed him Charles. So I thought, because that's more like a classic name as well.
Charles.
Right? So I kind of give them classic names, I think. Mm-hmm. What I consider classic. And even my own family, nieces. Like Kitty, Millie, you know, and Annie. These are very classic names in the UK still, you know, very old names, but they're still kind of, they go in and out of fashion if you want your name to be kind of fashionable, you know, but still classic, you know?
Mm-hmm. I know in traditional Chinese, like English classes, teachers are usually very focused on the grammar learning.
Yeah.
Do you think grammar is really important when, you know, when it comes to learning English?
For me, teaching oral English, I don't think is as important. I'm more concerned about you talking, just get it out. Mm-hmm. Say, this is how you learn. Your grammar will improve the more you speak, because you might be in here, all this information, but you're not able to express yourself, converse. I think it's important, but not as important. For me, just belongs you converse, communicate.
Exactly.
In English, you know, don't worry about, for me, don't worry about the dialect, don't worry about the accent, belongs you can communicate in English.
People can understand you, right?
Absolutely.
That's the ultimate goal.
Yeah.
Right? If you think of too many grammar errors, you're afraid of making, then it stops you from
expressing yourself. It slows you down. It slows you down.
Exactly.
And I think also, as I said earlier, many of my students are interested in different cultures.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, that's really important as well, you know, mm-hmm. to understand other people's cultures as well. You know, it's not just the language, it's their mindset, their mentality as well.
Very good. As long as you get to really understand the mindset, it also can really help you to develop your skill of thinking in mm-hmm. English.
Mm-hmm.
Because the language, behind language is culture, right? Mm-hmm. Once you understand the culture, it will help you really understand how those phrases, sentence structures, grammar, those things are wrong.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Absolutely.
Excellent. And also another thing that Chinese, like many English teachers, that like to pay attention to or are really focused on is vocabulary.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. In your opinion, is that important? And how big of a vocabulary is needed for a student to be able to, you know, speak freely, express themselves freely?
I think that, in my opinion, because most of them tend to use the same vocabulary, because mm-hmm. they're studying from the same textbook in their other classes.
Mm-hmm.
So then when they come to my class, I probably don't use many of the words that they use in the textbook, so they're listening to a native speaker, mm-hmm. so they listen to my vocabulary, and I tend to repeat some of the words because, you know, for them to remember a bit, everyday kind of language.
So the words from the textbooks are not very commonly used in spoken
mm-hmm.
English.
Mm-hmm. So I personally think they're a bit old-fashioned.
Old-fashioned.
Well.
Yeah.
So,
and also you don't want to sound bookish, right? The words are like from the books. You want to sound like really natural.
Yeah.
And also.
Yeah.
Easy to understand, right? I know some Chinese students, especially some students like to compete with each other. They like to compete with how difficult words they can understand. They try to use the long word, difficult word to say them out. If the people don't understand, that kind of can show how good their English is. They feel superior to others.
yeah, there's a lot of competition.
Yeah. But that's not right, right?
You know.
You don't want to talk to anyone and just to compete with the how many words you know.
Yeah. So my experience is like, come on, think of more descriptive words rather than saying good or bad, or modest is very popular, or humble is very popular words. Yeah, but they use the same. Not that I'm making fun of them, but I understand it. So I understand why they need a native teacher as well. You know, mm-hmm. it makes sense.
I see, yeah.
You know, in my opinion. But also to understand, I'm from a different culture. So I'm quite expressive person. Mm-hmm. I'm not really a reserved person, like a stereotypical British. I mean, I don't think I'm very loud. Maybe I am, I don't know. Maybe to them I'm loud, because they are far more reserved than I am. You know?
I see. They have to really come up on the shell, right? If you want to really speak well and learn the language, you have to open yourself up to others.
Absolutely. Yeah. Especially because sometimes I can see on their face, they thought, I don't think they understood me then. So then it's about the body language, and then obviously I use the board a lot.
And also about listen comprehension. Are there any techniques, or in your opinion, what are some good ways to improve listening comprehension?
Apart from my class, unfortunately they see me 80 minutes a week. So it's two classes. So 30.
So you'll give them some maybe materials to listen to?
I do, for me, it's the BBC is very good. BBC in English second language, and also the British Council. They're very good. Uh-huh. And there's lots of series, but they're not too long. So for example, when they walk to class, I said, plug your earphones in. You can listen to that. It's not too long. So you don't realize it, but you are taking it in. If you do that every day, just because I think, again, my experience, their listening skills and speaking skills, not so great as their reading and writing, and understandable because of how they've been educated. So that's what I think they need to practice more on, is the listening skills and speaking, you know. But these websites, these links, the BBC and British Council, I think are pretty good.
Good. So immerse themselves in the sound of like the English, right? English materials.
And films, they've watched some films. So for example, I talked about my culture when I first met them and showed them, maybe you know the film, Love Actually.
Of course, yeah, that's one of my favorites, yeah.
They loved
love
it.
Love is around.
Yeah. And it was appropriate because it was coming close to Christmas time as well. And they were like, wow.
It's very heartwarming movie. Yeah. It has different stories and all.
Exactly.
Great stories.
It was kind of easy for them to follow. They still have to watch it with subtitles, so they're still not at that level. They're not fluent,
So in your opinion, how can they learn from the subtitles?
Again, keep on watching. I think films are good, I think. I learned Spanish way too.
Not just watch it for once. Okay, I love the story, then I just threw it away, then I watch another one.
Yeah.
You go back to watch it again. Every time you watch it again, you'll learn something new.
Definitely. Even with me as a native, I watch film after film after film, and I go, I didn't see that before. I didn't see that before. I'm not, you know? You need to study it. But I think also we discuss the film afterwards. They're not used to that sort of critical thinking, you know? It's like, what do I dislike?
Yeah, what do I like that about? Yeah. What don't I like that about?
Phrases that maybe they've not heard of before, or they've heard of. Characters, you know? So we do discuss films as well. And so for them now, I've talked about it on Wednesday was my last class. And I said, look, this is a gauge for you. You've watched this film this year. Could you have watched it without the subtitles? And they went, not yet. And I said, well, watch it next year and the year after. Keep on watching it, right? And that's when you know, I think you can gauge, right, how good your listening skills
One
are.
One day, just boom, you understand.
It will
understand
all come together.
Yeah, without subtitles.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. And I think they think they're not learning enough. Some of the students think they're not learning enough, they're not quick enough. I said, but hang on a minute, you've been learning, studying for so long. So it's not going to rapidly come together now, because you have the background. It's practical. It's a process. It takes time.
Yeah, and gradually you'll get it.
I promise you, it will come. You keep at it. They have to, I realize they have to do their own self-study apart from one oral English class a week, because in my opinion, it's not enough.
Yeah, yeah. 80 minutes is not enough.
It's not enough. They have to do their own work, self-study as well. Mm-hmm. And we do have more foreign students on campus now. I believe we have about 1,500, maybe less, which is a lot.
Wow.
But obviously we have about 30,000 students on campus altogether, so there are many who want to have a foreign friend because they want to practice their English.
So that's a good way, right? To make friends with some foreigners to practice your English with.
And I think for some, they're in a position, maybe privileged position, that are able to go overseas, whether it's America or the UK. Mm-hmm. So and that will definitely improve immensely, you know.
Exactly.
It's like, wow.
So you put yourself in a certain situation or the place where you have to use English.
Yeah.
So that kind of the urgency or sense of need can help you discover your potentials.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And also if they go to travel, and like many they tell me, they share with me that they really want to go and travel the world.
Mm-hmm. So, but language is a tool you have to have, right, to help you.
Exactly. So that kind of motivates them a bit as well.
Oh, yeah, they need this kind of motivation.
Yeah, definitely.
Travel around the world, going study abroad.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Now they're great. It's been an amazing experience. As I said, I only came to China for 1 year. That was my plan. This is my fourth year.
I see. That shows how much you loved them and you loved
teaching. I love teaching. No, they're great.
Excellent. Mm. So any other plans you have for the future?
I'm going to be in America for a couple of months.
Uh-huh, okay.
So I like to go and travel a bit myself.
Your students will miss you terribly.
Yeah, I feel I miss them too. And I know next week is our last week together.
Uh-huh.
So we're actually celebrating. So I have 7 parties to go to next
week. 7 parties to go to, wow.
Really? So I'll be exhausted by the end of it. So
there's lots of joys.
Mm. And so I'm planning, end of June, beginning of July, to go to the States for a couple of months, and I'll be back then, back in China, and meet my new students. But also my former students, I still see them on campus, you know? Mm. I mean, there's so many.
Yeah.
So many, because it's been 3 years, right? So,
can see them, see the improvement they have made because of you.
Yeah. Well, maybe.
You're just being modest and humble.
Maybe I've adapted the Chinese culture now, right? I've become more modest and not so boastful.
But definitely you can see, right, the difference you can find out. On the first day they were in your class, nervous, afraid to say even a word. Mm. Then a few years later, they changed.
It's the self-confidence. That's what I love, because when you've got that confidence, there's no stopping you, you know, and I say this to them.
I see. I can sense that you must always encourage your students.
Yeah,
right?
Definitely.
To speak, to express themselves.
Yeah. And also, I was a student once. Okay, I wasn't learning Chinese as a major, but I was a student once. Mm-hmm. And I know sometimes, or most of the time, you're tired. So you can lose that motivation sometimes, or you feel a bit down about it, you know?
Yeah, and then
I thought, no, come on, keep on, you can do it.
Exactly.
You know, have an early night tonight.
It's not just about passing exams. Well, language is something you can really have fun with.
Exactly.
Right?
Enjoy it.
It brings a lot of joy.
Mm. And they know that I've traveled a lot also. I've traveled to over 20 countries in my lifetime. So I want them to do this, you know. If they want to do it, I'm not forcing them, but I just think it would be amazing if they can do this. So even if it's just one country, and they're happy with that, and they're content with that, and they come back to China, and it will change you. Your outlook is different. Your mind is more open, you know, because you have different experiences, right?
And then you'll be more confidence.
Confidence.
Yeah. Great. Thank you so much.
We wish you
all the best.
Thank you.
Looking forward to seeing you again.
Absolutely. Come and see you again. Thank you.
感谢观看今天的 ATalk 英语访谈。请持续关注我们节目。我们下次再见。谢谢。拜拜。